Okay, welcome everybody. My name is Miel Donkers. I'm working for Codecentric in the Netherlands. We have offices as well in Germany, quite a lot of them. Great presentation by the previous presenter, so I hope I can do a good job. We've been through all the same issues, so it's really true what you said. Start using Lagom tomorrow, you will love it. You can find my GitHub account over there, my Twitter handle. And this is what I would like to talk about today. A little bit about CQRS, the concepts, event sourcing, why they are... I want to tell a little bit more because they're quite important for Lagom, so you have a little bit more background for those who don't know the concepts. And then we'll look into the Lagom framework, highlight a little bit CQRS and event sourcing concepts in Lagom, and then we'll look at some code. So the why Lagom? Well, I was doing some stuff with CQRS and event sourcing with Akka, and I wanted to know how they, well, at that same time Lagom came out, and I wanted to see how they solved some stuff in Lagom about persisting and making sure everything is consistent, and started looking at it. And I like the framework. Like I said, I don't know if you should use it in production tomorrow, but it's quite interesting and I think has some promise. So who of you knows what CQRS is? Okay, quite a few. Who has really developed applications built on top of CQRS? A few, okay, cool. So I don't go that much in depth, but I'll go through it a little bit, especially the parts that are important to know for Lagom. So CQRS is about separating the command, the changing of data and the reading of data. And when you look at a traditional architecture, then you will see that the model is like a copy of the database. So it's one-to-one, you load in the model from the database and the model also goes to the UI. And when you change something from the inside the UI, then you change the model and the model gets persisted. So that's a traditional architecture. With CQRS, there it's split up. So you see there's different models. So the command model looks much more simple. And then the query model can still be the same copy with this structure, which is being read. But it's separated, that's the main part. And when the user wants to change something from the UI, it will go via the command. And that gets, so the state is updated, that gets persisted. And then it's being read back from the database and the query model. And you can make this really fancy, but looking at the most simple approach, it's just using a single database. And on one side, use normalized tables for writing the data. And at the other side, use denormalized views, or use views just to denormalize, so to get data from different tables. And you know, create a view that you can really easily query. We'll look at some examples later on. And the good part about this is that from your application point of view, you can keep the queries really simple and fast. You can really optimize in the database. CQRS is tightly related to domain-driven design in the sense that it can really benefit from taking this approach in designing your application and thinking about how it should be built up. So, for example, you have bounded contexts, which is the a grouping of entities that belong together. Then you have aggregates that are stored together with the aggregate root, so only the entities below the aggregate root, the other aggregates can only exist together with the aggregate root. And we have commands and we have events. And then this is from a simplified example from a use case at my current customer. I'm working at the Port of Rotterdam, and there the inspectors, they need to inspect ships and see whether everything is in order, like for safety and for environment. And this is basically the domain we have. And you see there's two bounded contexts. So we have ships here, and ships are coupled to a port visit. So when a ship comes into the port, then that's a port visit. And then we have inspection evaluations. So at the time a ship needs to register, sorry. And when then some inspector first needs to do an evaluation, is this ship, are the risks high enough to really go on board and do an inspection? Or is this, we've seen this ship often enough without issues, so we can just let it pass through. And you see there's always a template connected to the evaluation. And then at some point, a real inspection might be done. An inspection as a checklist, which is like the instance of a template, and then with items that are marked. For example, the containers are correctly secured and fixed, or stuff like that. And so this is one aggregate with here the aggregate route. So a checklist cannot exist without an inspection execution. And the same for the checklist items, they belong, they cannot exist without the inspection execution and the checklist. If there's any questions, please ask them or later, that's also fine. And so then looking at the command event and the state, so the user does an action which will lead to a command. And from that point on, an event is published. So, and at least this is, I don't know if really within the CQRS concept, you always publish an event and store that one, but at least this is also the way Lagom handles it. So a command results in an event, that one is persisted. And then the event also leads to an update of the state, which is, well, might be persisted, might not be persisted. And of course, the events can also lead to updates to different systems. And that get the state is queried by the UI. Very important concept, which I misuse a little bit in my demo later on, but a service should be tied to one bounded context and should own its data. So actually, from service B going directly to these tables is a big no-no, but like I said, I misuse it, but so every service should own its data and only access it directly. And then when service B needs something from service A, then use the APIs and not go to the database. So then a little bit about event sourcing. The event describes what we've seen already, describes the state change of the aggregate. And that one is persisted in the event store. And then you can replay all these events to get to the current state. So you can already see it's really tightly coupled to CQRS, this concept of event sourcing. So when you combine it, then you get an architecture like this. And if you want to know more about CQRS and event sourcing, this book by Microsoft, it's free. It's a really good read. And here you see like the simple scenario working with transactions. So it's separate tables, but they can be updated within one transaction, and in that way you always know that the what you store here below on the right side is consistent with what you have on the read side. And you see also from the interface you get a command and event is persisted and the event goes to the read side and there modifies the data. Of course, you can also do it in different ways, for example, with messages. And then the event is sent via message bus. more or less the same, but then it gets much harder to keep the data consistent. Especially there are not that many message buses supporting transactions. So then you need to implement all this logic yourself. So if you want to play with this, keep that in mind. We've had quite some issues with that. So sounds all good and nice, but of course there's some difficulties with CQRS and event sourcing. As I just mentioned, it's really difficult to keep it consistent, and you want to make sure that you're really reading the same data as you have written away. Difficult without transactions. One solution is by using versioning and timestamps, and make sure that you have these versions and timestamps in every event, so you can track whether they're following correctly on each other. And always keep in mind that you're talking about eventual consistency, because the read side will always lag behind on the write side. And I don't see this really as a big problem, because we live in a eventual consistent world. I mean, there's no two inspectors sitting behind two different systems, one doing the update and the other one checking immediately whether he sees this update. I mean, normally it doesn't work this way. So I think eventual consistency is fine, but keep in mind that it can take longer than a few seconds. And in the case of a failure, it might take minutes or even longer to reach this eventual consistency. And error handling is really important. And there you can distinguish between errors and business faults, because errors, you can retry them. So if something is an error, you can try again, and eventually it should succeed. A business fault is can be inconsistency in the data for some reason, and there you have a bigger problem. So you need to make sure to think about it and have a predetermined response. A good example, for example, is a seat reservation, where two people try to reserve the latest seat at once, and then the one person might succeed, and the other one will get a message. Well, sorry, it was reserved in the meantime. Another disadvantage is many moving parts. So if you go back a couple of slides, I mean, normally in without CQRS, it's only like one side that you have and have to keep up. But here you see already two sides, two stores. So many moving parts that if something goes wrong, then it can be really difficult to find the spot where it went wrong. And so keep in mind, CQRS is not for every bounded context. So make a good decision when you start using this. Is it useful? Is the environment complex enough? Or what are the benefits for using this instead of taking the simple approach? Of course, there are advantages. One of them is the auditing and the tracing. By keeping the track of events, you know exactly what happened in time. The read and the write side can be optimized separately. You can easily take the event stream and use it in a local environment to do some debugging. And in itself, the components are quite small, so those are quite easy to fix if something might be wrong. Of course, you can have issues that if it's a data problem, you need to fix it through all the systems. So then they have issues still. But lastly, there's no object relational mapping impedance mismatch. And what we mean with that is that with objects, you can have these hierarchies and complex structures with inheritance and stuff like that. And that's really complex to bring to a database. So you need different tables for the different different things. And by storing events, are always one record. So you don't have different tables you need to take into account. So that makes storing the event much easier. And also on the write side, because you can, for example, use these views or prepare your data, then you also can query it as one record. So depending a little bit on what you need, but that they really solve this impedance mismatch. Okay, then on to the Lagom framework. So the design philosophy behind it is distributed. So everything, well, Lagom is a microservices framework, so they expect all these services to be distributed and talking with each other. Everything is asynchronous. And they want to keep in mind high productivity. So the tooling around it is set up in such a way that you can quite easily test it and develop stuff. Then some concepts. So like I said, the concept of microservices, distributed small components, small services with their own data. It's something they kept in mind. Polyglot. They both have the Java API and recently the Scala API with version 1.3.0. But also by using and building on REST services, you can easily interact with other systems built in other languages. The APIs are from a built up from a design-driven perspective. Everything is immutable. In Scala, of course, that's easy. But in Java, they're using the immutables library to make sure that you can create immutable events, immutable commands, everything. And what we're talking about here, event sourcing and CQRS. And it's highly opinionated, so that's also part of this productivity. And you can see an example. This is a Java example. The other code examples will be in Scala, but if you look at the code and the interface you need to call, it's almost a one-to-one copy. But what you see here is that it's a service call taking a source as input and a source as output. And this already makes it a streaming API. So by itself, it will see, okay, this is source, so it's set up as a streaming API. And if I switch to code, then here I have my, so this is Scala, and here I have my interface for my inspection service. And you can see I have four methods, so four different calls. And for example, taking the first one, which is here a path call, taking a ship name as parameter, and it has here the service call defined as not used, and with a set as result, and it's automatically made into a GET request because it's not taking like the message body, it's not taking any data in, only this parameter, and it gives back a set. So Lagom automatically makes a GET call out of this, and the same. Well, here I mentioned those explicitly, GET and POST, but if you look at the POST, it's it will take the inspection message as an input. So that's the body, and done as a result, and that's so done is just when it's finished, and this will automatically become a post. So even without this explicitly mentioning here, it will be a post. So Lagom is built on some core technology. Lagom is from Liveband, formerly TypeSafe. And these core technologies will not surprise you. So it's using Akka, Akka Streams, Akka Persistence for the CQRS event sourcing part, Akka Cluster to connect various services. Then Play, more or less for configuration and tying everything together. And then Conductor. And that's more or less the tie-in for Liveband, because if you want to deploy this in production, then Conductor will take care of the scaling and the service discovery, and it's free for local use, but for a production environment you need to pay for it. There are ways to also work around this, but I haven't tried it out. But Conductor is the preferred method, as they say. And then there's some other technologies also being used. For example, for Java, they use Juice for dependency injection. Like I said before, immutables for immutability. For Scala, MacWire is being used. So a lot of well-known libraries are built in. Then on to persistence. By more or less by default, at least this was the only available solution in LaGom 1.0, 1.1 was Cassandra. So where you use Cassandra as a persistent storage. And to make use of this, you create a persistent entity, and this requires command, event, and states to be defined, so objects. And then what LaGom will do, it will always keep a single instance in memory. So if you look at, for example, Hibernate, then you can query a certain object and have one instance. But if in a different piece of your code you query for the same object, you will get a second instance in your memory. LaGom will always, for your persistent entity, keep a single instance. And when it's not being used for some time, then it will be the state will be persisted to disk, and as soon as you use it, it will load it back in. And the state is being built up, so events are being persisted in Cassandra, and then when you start up LaGom, then it will read back these events and it will build up your state in memory. So just as a reminder, the same model. So you send in a command, the event gets persisted by LaGom, and from that it will build up the state. And the state is only persisted to disk when not being used. But what I like is, if I want to do querying, and that's also what we do in current project, JDBC or SQL database can be really have its strength, because you can query over multiple tables, you can create views, you can really optimize it. So Cassandra is nice, but I want to use a SQL database. And that's possible since LaGom 1.2. And for example, something we have in our situation is what I at some point, what an inspector wants to know is, for this given ship, give me all inspection executions with remarks. So because I want to see quickly whether I need to inspect the ship again, yes or no. And you can see that you have to query over quite some entities. And they're really the strength of a view. And like I mentioned before, you shouldn't do this with microservices and having these bounded contexts, but we have a monolith more or less still, so we can do this. And then you create your views over your data and really get a good performance on that. Like I mentioned, since 1.2, so it uses Slick for that, for JDBC. And Slick also makes sure that all the database actions are asynchronous and then can be used for storing and reading entities. So let's see it. What I did in my example, I will show you quickly the service, but then how the entities are persisted, the events themselves, and then also see how we can send the event to like the read side and store it in your own way, as for example a denormalized table. Let's see if we have everything running. Yeah, so this is SBT at the bottom, and with the run all command I can start up, so we can have a demo also a little bit later on. I already mentioned these interfaces, so what I can do, I can add an inspection get inspections for a ship and then take the ship name, or I can get all inspections or by employee. And the inspections by ship, that's the one in the example that I want to know with the remarks. So if you look at the implementation, then first let's see the querying and the storing of data. So for example, here we have the add inspection, and it will get the request. So the request is the HTTP body, and that's automatically with Play there converting this from JSON to an object. And you can see that we get here, well, we have a UCREN is the unique call identifier for a visit of the visit of a ship in the harbor, a time of inspection, employee and remarks. And it will get here the persistent entity registry. And right here I'm using a fixed ID. So normally you might have some identifier that you want to split up. So I think it's defined at the top. I just have inspections. That's because I'm just gathering a list of inspections. So we'll dive into that. So this is our persistent entity. And you can see we need to define command, event, and state. And first let's look at those. So my inspection state is just a list of inspections. So every time when I create a new inspection, I add one to the list. Here you can see you also need to define all the JSON conversion, but it's done automatically unless you have really some specific fields that it cannot handle automatically. Inspection, same data as we saw before, using options for optional data. Of course, we have an inspection event, and that actually, you need to define like a general, more like interface object, and then the implementation. So I have an inspection edit event here, and that's what being actually persisted. And then an inspection command, and that's the add inspection command. But also for the query side, you need to define commands. So I have here my request all inspections command, and my request inspections by employee command. So those are the ones that I'm. So you can choose with Lagom. You can query directly the state that's being kept in memory. And later on, we'll look at querying to the SQL database. Let's go. So having one quick look here. They see that when the add inspection is being called, I create a new add inspection command with these fields. And then we need to define, within our entity, we need to define behavior. So our initial behavior is an empty list. And then when the when we receive the add inspections command, then you can see that this command is converted to a inspections edit event. And of course, you could do some validation here, could check whether this command is can be executed. Then it's persisted. And then here at the bottom on event, let me do it this way. Here you can see that this inspection edit event is actually being handled and updating the state. So we create a new state, which is actually the list of inspections. and one is added to the list. And also, you have the read-only command handlers. So those are only for querying your data, and you get the state. And for example, for the top one, we get all inspections back, so the full set. Or actually, we have here a list, so we convert this to the set that I'm expecting later on. And in the by employee, there we do a filter based on the employee name. Not that difficult, but it's a simple example. What you could do here is also with the kind of state pattern, you could change, for example, which state you're in, and then change the behavior depending on if you have a command, and then later on get a different command, and maybe you need to take different actions. So you can. This is a place where you can put business logic, or at least refer to your business logic. Yeah. No, this is still for the. You should see for the right side. So Lagom always uses when you want to access the persistent entities, you always need to do it via commands. And here I'm still having this state in memory. So you can see the state which contains a list of inspections, and I have to do it via command. But the difference is with this other command is that I'm not persisting the event. So I'm just reading, no data is being changed, but as soon as I change data, then a command needs to lead to an event. And what happens when I start up Lagom, it will replay all these events and actually go basically through these on events, and in that way handle and recreate the state from scratch. Now the JDBC, well, let me show you the because you need to create a table for this. Yeah, the tables are good to show anyway. So Lagom can create these tables automatically for you, or you can do it yourself. But you can see it will create use a journal table. And there all these events are persisted, and a snapshot table and read offsets, those are for the read side, whether it processed all the events. So we'll go, that's the next thing to show. You can define a read side processor, and besides the events going in that persistent entity and update the state, you can capture those same events and update, for example, the your tables. So this is just, if you look at this journal table, if you look at this journal table, you will see just all these events persisted one by one. And Lagom will replay those. So what I did here is you defining the event processor. And also this can be based upon Cassandra. So also the read side you could implement or use the event processor together with Cassandra. I chose to use a SQL database everywhere. But here you see you define as well a method to handle a stream of events of the type inspection edit event. And then what will happen every time I create a new event, Lagom will make sure I also receive it here. And here I actually update the table, so I insert the same information within this inspections table. And so this is, you could do this also with Slick, but here I'm using direct JDBC statements. You could use object relational mapping. And then what Lagom will do for you, it will keep track whether all events were handled. So say you have one event which is persisted in the journal and then sent to this processor, but the processor, the system crashes and the processor didn't handle it, or you shut down the system, then Lagom will know which events were handled on this side and won't process them there again. And then I created a view. That basically does so. I created separately a ship table and a port visit table. And then I'm filling from Lagom, I'm filling the inspection table. And what I did here was create a view to create one view with all this this data. So if you then go to the demo, and I should have, if you see now which inspections I have in the system, those are two. So one by Jan and one by Fritz. And actually, here I cheated as well. So that's the difficulty of keeping the system consistent, because at some point I cleaned the information in Lagom, so it only has two inspections here. But if I go to inspections by ship, search for the Orient, you see I have more here, but the last one is from Fritz. So what I can do now is I can create a new inspection. To be clear, created by Voxt. Let's see. I can create it and receive the 200. Okay, so the event got processed correctly. If I now get all inspections that are stored by are stored in the journal, so this is the state, then you can see that this one is put on top, so it's being received. And let's see, now we query from the read side. There it is in the middle, because this is a set that's not ordered. So you see that Voxt is put in there in between. So what it did is taking the port visit ID and from there going to the ship and then correlates the data. So I think that's basically what I, at least for the demo part, unless someone wants to see a thing again, or we can do it later. Let's go back to the, let's round up. So all these conventions within Lagom, those make it really easy to set things up and get started. And for some very basic logic, which I showed you here, that's cool. I think when you, that's of course with every application, but as soon as you get more into complex business logic and stuff, you really need to think about which commands to handle and when to handle them. Make sure that they are discarded when not correct and when you cannot update, for example, also the read side. What I mentioned before, Lagom is built on top of all these other frameworks, and in general, you don't see that much of them. But sometimes they shine through, and that's not always a good part. I think if you're going to build complex systems, you will need to know and learn about these frameworks down below. So. And also a lot of stuff is abstracted away. So when things go wrong, if you don't know these frameworks, it's difficult to know where the issues are and what went wrong. And I recently, because of the Scala APIs, built this in Scala, and I'm not that a good Scala developer. So things are more concise. It's more easy to set things up, but it, yeah, sometimes I have something like, okay, this feels a little bit like magic, and I'm trying stuff, and at some point, woohoo, it works. And then, well, so it feels like magic, but it does the job. One example of this issue I had at some point, and with all the abstractions away and all the frameworks, is I'm using a Reveal.js presentation, which was I had running on port 8000. And at some point, I was working on the presentation and starting up Lagom, and I got this strange message. And reading this, it seems like it cannot reread all the events upon startup. I don't know, it's known sequence number. I couldn't make sense of it. And I was trying different things and couldn't get it to work. And finally, I gave up and restarted my computer. And then, of course, I didn't have the presentation running. And the issue was the service locator is running on the same port, so it couldn't start the service locator. But I mean, nowhere in this message you can make sense of that there's a port clash or something. So that was, that was quite an issue. Took me a couple of hours. If you want to learn more, you can find, of course, Martin Fowler has some information about CQRS. The CQRS Journey book from Microsoft is really good. The Lagom, well, you can find this presentation on the internet as well. So those are links. And then all the demo code is on my GitHub. So that's basically it. Thank you. I don't know if there's any questions. Okay, well, thank you very much, and have a nice day.